Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Three times, Jesus asks Peter. And three times, I love you, I love you, I love you. You know that I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. But when you look at this in the original text, it's much more interesting. Because Peter, Jesus asks one question and Peter asks another. And the way it goes is like this. Do you love me? Agape. Agape, the Greek word for sacrificial love, not eros or philia, brotherly love, but do you agape me? And Peter says, Lord, you know that I philia you. I love you like a brother. Jesus, and he says, okay, then feed my babies. This literally the three, okay. The second time Jesus asks, do you agape me? And Peter says, I already told you. I philia you. I do. I love you. I like you. Care for my men sheep. In the Greek, what we see as sheep, feed my sheep, tend my sheep, feed my sheep. That's not what it says. It says lambs, babies, and then the second one is male sheep, rams, and the third one is female sheep, ewes. So the third time, again, the question comes from Jesus, but this time, Jesus doesn't ask, do you agape me? The sacrificial love question, since all Peter gets is filial love, Jesus asks him, do you really philia me? Do you really love me like a brother? And he answers, he's still clueless. Yes, yes, I've told you, I do. I love you like a brother. Feed my ewes. It's a fascinating text. And then, he tells Peter, he goes to the freedom thing. When you were free as a young man and you went everywhere you want, you just put your own pants on and you put your belt on and, you know, cinched your belt, you went wherever you want. But when you are older, they will put a belt around you and they will drag you where you do not wish to go. Peter is crucified, as Jesus was, upside down. Who killed Peter? Who crucified Peter? Who crucified Jesus? And who is the author of the book of Revelation writing about? Do you know? The Roman Empire. The Roman Empire is the only one that crucifies. Nobody else has a cross as a means of torture and execution. So Jesus dies at the hands of the Roman Empire. Peter will die at the hands of the Roman Empire. John is writing about the end of the Roman Empire. Feed my lambs. Tend my sheep. Feed my ewes. I think I've heard this so many times over the course of my life. The question is, how do you love Jesus? How do you love the Jesus who is no longer the historical Jesus, the earthly Jesus, the pre-crucifixion Jesus? How do you love that Jesus? And I think this is answering the question. Love each other. You want to love me? There's only one way to love me, and that's to love your brothers and your sisters. Filial love. And if you practice that long enough, brotherly love, really liking each other, more than that, filial love is not just like. I may not like you, you may not like me, but you can love me as though I were your brother or your sister. If we do filial love, eventually Jesus is saying to Peter, who doesn't get it, eventually you will get it. You will get to agape if you start with what you have, filial love. So start there and start taking it seriously, and in time you will develop the higher love of agape. This last, I guess it was last Saturday a week ago, I got a call from Chris Peterson. Christina Peterson is a Presbyterian pastor of the Bayou Blue Presbyterian Church in Louisiana, Gray, Louisiana. And Christina Peterson and her husband, Dick Krajewski, were here at Shepherd of the Hill 2 years ago, a year after Deepwater Horizon, to tell us what was really happening. So Christina is not only the pastor at the Bayou Blue Presbyterian Church, but she is also a researcher and an expert in disaster recovery with communities that have been affected by mining accidents and oil accidents, with the University of New Orleans Center for Hazard Assessment and Risk Technology. So she's on this case big time. She's working day and night with the subsistence communities along the coast of Gulf of Mexico. Well, she called from the Detroit airport on Friday and said, we're stuck in Detroit and we're waiting to hoping to get out of Detroit. We're not sure about the weather, but we're coming through Minneapolis on our way to Duluth to a conference of Native American people. And those who are along all the way from the headwaters of the Mississippi down to the mouth of the Mississippi. And she said, I have Chief Albert Nachin with me. Would you like to interview him? Boy, would I like to interview? Who is he? She explained to me that Albert Nachin, N-A-Q-U-I-N, is the chief of this small band of Indians, Native Americans, who in 1830 were part of the Choctaw. And they, when the 1830, the government came to resettle everybody, all the Native Americans. And this group took off because they didn't want to be resettled, and so they hid in the Delta of Louisiana and in a plot of land in the marshland along the coast, quite a ways inland actually, in the Delta, in the marsh. That piece of land, I learned from talking with the chief, when they moved there, was 10 miles long and 5 miles wide. They were subsistence people. They were subsistence fisher people. They fished the oysters. They fished the shrimp. They fished for the kind of fish that you and I, probably not trout, but the kind of fish that you and I fish for, those of us who are fisher people. They had horses. They had cows. They had cattle. They had chicken. They raised their own vegetables. It was a lush place, a productive place, a wonderful place. It was a barter system. I grew some vegetables, you brought in some shrimp, I gave you vegetables, you gave me shrimp. It was a subsistence culture, and it still is. About 1940, the chief said, the oil companies got permission to cut canals through the marsh, through the delta, to go after the oil. And one by one, they cut these canals, these wide canals that brought the seawater in to the freshwater. And lo and behold, don't you know, these canals crossed one another and the marshland disappeared. Until now, the size of the island is 2 miles long, once 10 to 2, and it is now not 5 miles wide, but 1/4 mile wide. And the chief is trying to get the people to come off of this island and to be resettled somewhere else. What was fascinating to me, among many things, in the time with Christina and with Chief Naqueen, who was just wonderful, wonderful man, cheerful, has a great face and a great way of talking, and Chuck has taped the conversation, a 50-minute conversation that is really between Christina and the Chief Albert Naqueen. And we'll make that available on the church website for those of you who wish to see it. But one of the things that struck me is that this was a community that, in the chief's words, was in hiding. They went there to hide. They went there to be left alone. And Albert said when he would go out and leave the house, his mother would say, "Now, if you see anybody on the island that you don't know, you hide." Hide. Well, they can't hide anymore. They can't hide anymore. They have to fight now for their lives. They have to. He says that in preparation for the third anniversary of Deepwater Horizon, whoever has the vested interest has now, there are no oysters. The oysters are where he is. The oysters are gone. There are no shrimp. All there are oyster shells on the bottom. Do you know, I learned 15, 20 years ago in a trip to the Chesapeake Bay, I learned from an oysterman named Earl who had been fishing the oysters in the Chesapeake Bay for 50 years, and then from the Chesapeake Bay Foundation, that a single oyster filters 300 gallons of water a day. Does that blow your mind? 300 gallons of water a day go through the oyster and the impurities are filtered by that oyster. And then we eat them, anyway. Well, in preparation for the third anniversary of Deepwater Horizon, all of the media are coming down, and lo and behold, wouldn't you know it, they're all fishing for oysters and they're bringing these oysters right up. It's just wonderful. Everything is just fine on the coast of Louisiana. Everybody's fishing. Look at the oysters they're bringing up. Those oysters have been placed there for the television cameras. Oh, isn't that wonderful? You know, when Jesus was here, the earthly historical Jesus, I don't think Jesus ever had to care about oysters. The environment was not in danger in Jesus' time. It wasn't even part of Jesus' consciousness. I think if he were standing here today, he would say, take care of my oysters. Take care of my shrimp. Take care of the seawater. Stop this. Stand up. Stand up. If you want to love me, stand up and take some risks. I like you, Jesus. I like you. I like you. How do I love Jesus now? How do you love Jesus now? Well, the first thing is we just start where we are. We love each other. I love you, you love me. That's the place to start, with those closest to us. But when, let's just assume here in Chaska, when there is a factory that is dumping PCBs into the water of the Mississippi, and we're drinking water, our drinking water comes out of the Mississippi, how do you love your neighbor? How do you love your neighbor? And how do you love yourself as you love your neighbor? You gotta go after that factory.
Is that so?
To stop the PCBs going into the river.
Is that so?
Pardon?
Is that so?
Oh, no, it's an example.
Oh.
It's an example. No, there's...
All
the factories in Chaska are just doing great stuff. I don't have a clue. I don't have a clue. It's a preposterous... I hope it is a preposterous example. But so Albert Nakhlin and Christina Peterson were up in Duluth for this conference, Native American people talking about the headwaters of the Mississippi flowing all the way down into the Gulf of Mexico, and the delta in the Gulf of Mexico is quickly disappearing. And in the delta, in the BP settlements, both Christina and Albert confirmed subsistence people are getting nothing. And you know why? Because they don't have a W-2. If you're part of the system and you own a business or you're employed by a business, you take it in and the distributors of the BP settlement say, okay, well, you lost this much income, you lost so forth and so on. So what do you do if you're Albert? And you go in and you say, you know, I lost my food supply. I had to go out and buy chicken that was all pumped up with steroids, and look at me now. I gained a lot of weight here because I'm eating this food. Why am I telling you this? This has nothing to do with Peter and with Jesus. I think it does, and I would like nothing better to hide. I want to hide, don't you? I want to just stay home and not deal with any of this stuff anymore. I don't want to get upset. I don't want to get angry. I don't want to march. I don't have to respond to all the emails that I get. If you do this, if you do this, if you want to stop this, then reply and sign this petition. I could spend all day signing petitions. I want to hide. But I can't love Jesus that way, can I? I can't. Agape, second mile love. Agape, sacrificial love. In the letter to the Colossians, finally, the author of the letter says that in the cross of Christ, the Roman cross, the principalities and powers were nailed to that cross. They were defeated in the cross of Jesus. Over and done. In principle, their power is over and done. But for us, it is over and done in the midst of time, in hope, in courage, and in love. And we must engage the principalities and the powers that lord over us. Jesus himself is the Lord of lords and the King of kings. Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, the King of love and the Lord of peace. Those who shout the loudest about loving Jesus, the question is whether you shout loudly, compare your love of Jesus with somebody else. Do you love me more than these? Do you love me, Gordon, more than everybody else out there? Oh, yes, I do. Just listen to me shout. Listen to me say, I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. And then one of his sheep is hungry, and I don't feed it. One of the sheep is in prison, and I don't go visit. In the 25th chapter of the Gospel according to Matthew, remember what the story that Jesus tells about the sheep and the goats? Insofar as you have done it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you have done it to me. I am with you in the least of these, my brothers and my sisters. That's where you find me, and that's how you love me. And the only difference between the sheep and the goats is this. The goats say, Jesus, why didn't you tell us you were there? Why didn't you tell us? We didn't know. If you'd have told us it was you, we would have done it. Jesus says, insofar as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you didn't do it to me. You can't worship me. You can't love me unless you love your neighbors. And those who think that they're goats or who don't know that they're sheep say, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or in prison or naked? When? We never saw you. And the judge says, oh, yes, you did. Oh, yes, you did. Insofar as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers, you did it to me. The name of faith in Christ is compassion. The name for faith in Christ is standing up, watching with him until the kingdom come. May the Lord bless us and keep us. in his strength and in his mercy, by the power of the Holy Spirit, blessings on the people of Ile-de-Jean-Charles, Chris, Christina, each of us here in Chaska, as we follow Jesus, loving one another, and loving for the other creatures, the oysters, the shrimp, and the fish. Amen.